welcome to Sunday Night Service. I'm so glad you've taken time to tune in to be able to be together in fellowship and the study of God's Word. I'm excited to see what God's going to do with us tonight on this glorious Sunday. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, I thank you. Thank you so much for the body of Christ, Lord, as we're able to, Lord, just to gather together to grow in our knowledge of you. Lord, just to see you work in our midst, to watch the free work of the Holy Spirit within your church, within your body. Lord, we ask that you might be glorified here tonight, not only in song and worship, but in your word. Lord, our hearts would be encouraged. Lord, the needs of our church, we just pray that you might strengthen those who are sick, heal, Lord, and also those who are discouraged. Lord, this past few days, we've seen a lot of trouble in our land. And once again, people are out on the streets. Lord, they're looking for answers. We know ultimately the only real answer that we have is found in Jesus. But Lord, we ask on behalf of our president and his nation, Lord, that you might bring peace back to this land. Lord, that you might calm the people's hearts, Lord, and bring encouragement, Lord. We ask this, Lord, in the name of Jesus, that you might work in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Yes, it's troubling when you see these things happen. There in Minneapolis, I grew up in across the way on the other side of the river, a city called South St. Paul. So I'm very familiar with the area. And when you saw the rioting and really the disgusting events that led up to that by the policemen, you know, you just kind of wonder, what will our world ultimately be if it's just left for men to govern? I thank God we look for a righteous judge, Jesus Christ the righteous, that ultimately will restore things the way God intended to be, where we're able to live in the joy, the peace, and the love that God would have us to live. Why don't we go and worship the Lord, and then we'll be back for a brief announcements before this evening's study.
Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Sometimes it causes me to tremble, tremble, tremble. Were you there when they crucified my Lord? And were you there when they nailed him to the tree? Were you there when they nailed him to the tree? Well, sometimes it causes me to tremble, tremble. Were you there when they nailed him to the tree? Were you there when they laid him in the tomb? Were you there when they laid him in the tomb? Well, sometimes it causes me to tremble, tremble. Were you there when they laid him in the tomb? I feel like shouting, glory, glory. Were you there when he rose up from the tomb? Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Thank you.
all we need to please you. But we fail so commonly. Light our way, Lord, right so we won't fall. Teach us to call on you more faithfully. Light our way, Lord, right so we won't fall. Teach us to call on you more faithfully. God bless you.
How many of you out there believe in angels? Good. I'm glad, because this next song is about an angel. And it's about a conversation that took place between a guy and an angel. And this is what the angel told him. To share his love with you, just to tell you once again what took place at Calvary. He took him who knew no sin, and they nailed him to a tree, and he paid.
Ready, boys?
Yo.
One, two, three. I don't cheat on my woman. There's no adultery in my heart. So this song might not be sordid enough to get it on the country charts. Now clean living might not sell records. I ain't looking for any fans. When I say I love my darling wife and I'm a happily married man. Now if I had a lover waiting in every town, I'd have enough songs for an album or two telling how I fooled around. worst can. I may not have a hit, but in spite of it, I'm a happily married man. Happily married man, signed, sealed, and faithful. From the beginning, that's the way the good Lord had it planned. And when it comes to being hitched, Jerry, play something right. Now divorce is gone big business. To fool around is really in. People dress it up and call them love affairs, but God just calls it sin. But what they need is the good Lord's guidance, the foundation of his mighty hand, to bind a happily married woman. Happily married man, happily married man, signed, sealed, and faithful. From the beginning, that's the way the good Lord, he had a plan. And when it comes to being hitched, I'd rather fight than switch. Beginning, that's the way the good Lord, he had a plan. And when it comes to being hitched, I'd rather fight than switch. That is why I'm taking a heavenly married stand.
I don't think they heard you.
That is why I'm taking a heavenly married stand. I'm going to say it a little louder.
All right.
That is why I'm taking a heavenly married stand.
Praise the Lord. Thank you so much. You guys are out of sight tonight. Thank you. We're going to take some of that energy and put it to good use right now and ask you to participate with us on this next song. This is a little country and western type of song that you can clap your hands and make a joyful noise unto the Lord tonight with us. Next song, I'm sure that you'll all recognize, and I'd just like to say about this song that I'm really thankful that the lyrics to this next song can be true, and that there's a change, a real change starting to happen in our churches, and no longer are they just remaining buildings, but they are becoming buildings made out of living stones of people who know and love Jesus Christ. And this next song kind of chronicles what's been happening in, you know, we call it the Jesus movement, quote, because the press calls it that. But Really, we prefer to think of it as the movement of Jesus. It's the same thing that's been going on for 2,000 years. And the only thing different about it now is that there's a lot of publicity about it, you know. And I just praise the Lord that this next song can be a true song and not just a nice little tune somebody made up about something they wish could be.
Was great. As I've been mentioning the last few days, our last few services, we're going back next Sunday, June 7th. I know some churches opened up today already where they were able to meet in their sanctuaries, but we weren't quite ready as far as our facility and everything. We just, you know, weren't there at a time we thought that next week would be a better start date. Not only are we starting, but Poema Fellowship is starting next Sunday also. And so I would encourage you to come to be there once again. We're going to be having our services out there in the gazebo area where we've done many times in the summer before. We'll start off there on Sunday mornings and Sunday nights and midweek, and we'll have overflow into our social room. That way, if you're, you know, feel like you want to sit indoors, they ask us to wear masks if we're indoors, but we could do that. And in fact, you might see some masks in the mail here in the next couple of days, and a letter from us just kind of describing what's going on. And so we're very, very much looking forward to this. And I would ask you to be in prayer up to it. A friend of mine, Bill Henry, up there in I think his church is called Simple Faith up there in Oregon. He asked for prayer today, and this week, as a lot of churches are feeling opposition from their governors and their mayors and their cities and from reopening, and they're concerned that they're going to arrest some of them. So please keep them in prayer. Right now, we're following the guidelines as Costa Mesa has put out for us and what the community center has done for us. And so not only myself, but Odin are making sure we adhere to things so that it would be a safe place for you to go to church and to fellowship. And so if you're watching online, you've never been here before, I would highly, highly encourage you to join us with that. But this Thursday night, of course, we will be back in chapter 2. The book of Colossians. This is a great chapter. Excuse me, chapter 3. That's why I was a little confused. Chapter 3 this week, as we'll be dealing with forgiveness and really the Christian walk. It's going to be exciting. I'm looking forward to teaching it. And so I will see you Thursday evening again online. We're not quite there again. Our opening is a week from today, next Sunday. So this will be. Well, could be our last one in studio for Sunday night, so hopefully we'll be streaming from outdoors there on Sunday morning. So if you have your Bible, why don't you turn with me to Psalm 17. Psalm 17. Psalm 17, of course, is a prayer of David. This prayer is thought to be offered when David was was younger in his life, as he was being Saul was in pursuit of him, trying to take him out, and we see in his life where David was asking the Lord to bless him for righteousness' sake, for the things that how he was living his life, doing the best we can. Of course, later on in his life, as he grew a little older and as he had a few troubles in his life, he started asking the Lord to bless him for mercy's sake. He got it, you know. But David had tremendous faith in God, especially as a young lad and as he grew up. Here in our story, he had seen the killing of lions. He certainly the killing of bears that he was able to do, and he was willing to go up against Goliath. You remember that story that we have in 1 Samuel chapter 17. In fact, because that early trust in the Lord was manifest to fight, he was willing, he had that encouragement to go up against this tremendous man, Goliath. And Goliath said to David, if you remember the story, he says, "Am I a dog that you should send a child to fight against me?" And he said to David, "Go home before I cut you up and feed you to the birds." That's what Goliath was saying. But David expressed this tremendous faith he had in God. He says, "You come against me with sword and with a spear," David is saying, "but I come against you in the name of the living God that you have defiled. I will cut you up and your whole army and feed you to the birds." He just had this tremendous confidence of God. Obviously, in our story, as you go through 1 Samuel, you'll see how David also had a great respect for the God's anointed, which was Saul. And he wasn't wanting to take things in his own hands. He is actually running for Saul as Saul was trying to kill him. The whole tone of David's prayers I mentioned changes as the years went by, as he experienced his own weaknesses when he fell into sin, and he realized his need for mercy as he cries out. Notice in verse number 1. "Hear the right, O Lord, attend unto my cry. Give ear unto my prayer that goeth not out of fringe words." He says they're not coming out of deceptive words, really what he's saying. I'm not giving you double talk. I've been trying to be honest and trying to lay my case before you. He says, "Let my sentences come forth from thy presence. Let thine eyes behold the things that are equal." Lord, I'm looking for equality here. He felt that he was really innocent before Saul, which he was. Saul was accusing him and trying to destroy David. And he's simply praying. He's asking God that things would be equal. Verse 3, "Thou hast proved mine heart," or "was tested my heart." Isn't that something? We were just studying that in the book of James, how God tests us and tries us. "Thou hast proved my heart. Thou hast visited me in the night. Thou hast tried me and shall find nothing. I am purposed that my mouth shall not transgress." And I think that's something that we should all hold fast to. Where David said, I am purposed that my mouth shall not transgress. I made a decision not to sin against thee, not to transgress against the ways of the Lord. And God honors that, and he helps us when we make that conscious decision. I'm not going to go that way. I'm not going to follow that way. I'm not going to go down that path, no matter what they might dangle in front of me, speaking of the things of the world. I'm not going to go that way. Verse 4. Concerning the works of men, by the words of thy lips, I have kept me from the path of the destroyer. As he talks now, he says, through the word of God. Did you see that? By the words of thy lip. The words of God came to David as David had hid him within his heart. David had kept himself from the path of the destroyer. The word of God can be that deterrent. It helps lead us. It guides us. It shows us the route that we should go on to keep us from our problems. In Psalm 119, verse 11, we read, and David here attributes that he stands in the righteousness to this fact, where David said, "Have I hid in my heart, O Lord, that I might not sin against thee." Let me read the whole thing. It says, "Thy word," David said, "I have hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee." That word of God is a deterrent. That's why I encourage you to just to meditate, to think on, to allow the Word of God to dwell within your heart richly. We'll be talking more about that on Thursday night in Colossians chapter 3, that we might receive God's Word. God's Word is powerful against temptation. It's so important that we fortify inwardly, that we build a defense inwardly. And really the tools that we should be using, or the building blocks inside of our heart, if you could think of it as a fort, is the Word of God. When Jesus faced the temptations of Satan, he responded to every temptation by how? By the Word of God. It is written, he said, and he quoted the word of God to Satan as his defense. In Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12, we read, "The word is alive and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword," and referred to as the sword of the Spirit in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 16. And believing the greatest defense is a good offense. And the word of God within our heart is a tremendous defense against the powers and the subtleties, the craftiness of our enemy. And so we read in our verse, "By the words of your lips, I have kept from the path of the destroyer." God's word is that keeping force. Verse number 6. "I have called upon thee, for thou wilt hear me, O God. Incline thine ear upon me, and hear my speech." So he's praying to God for an audience. You know, the beauty is that we can call upon him at any time, any moment, anywhere, and God will listen to us. Because not only do my sheep hear my voice, as far as we hear the voice of Jesus, he hears us when we say, "Bah, bah," because he's the great shepherd. But David's crying. He says, "Oh, Lord, I got problems. Would you please give me a time that you will listen to me?" Verse 7. "Show thy marvelous loving kindness, O thou that savest by thy right hand, them which put their trust in thee, for those that rise up against thee." And he's calling upon God's loving kindness, because truly that's his nature. God is so loving and he's so kind. And I love how they put that word together, loving kindness. He says, "And thou will save by the right hand," otherwise you're by the hand of strength, "you will save those who put their trust in thee." You know, the beauty is that our lives should be that we trust the Lord at every corner that we're living, that we're going through. In verse 8, "Keep me as the apple of thy eye, hide me under the shadow of thy wings." In the 32nd chapter of Deuteronomy, The Psalm of Moses, of course, and no doubt David had memorized the Psalm of Moses, most young Jewish boys, and it was a strong of the traditional Jewish song that they would sing. In the 10th and 11th verse, in the last portion of the 10th verse in Deuteronomy chapter 32, he speaks about how God led him about, not as Jacob, as the apple of an eye, as just something special in the eye of God. And then he says, as an eagle stirreth up the nest, fluttereth over the young, as spreadeth about the wings, and taketh them, and beareth them on her wings, so the Lord alone did lead them. And there is no strange God with him. Deuteronomy chapter 32, 10 through 12. And so keep me as the apple of thy eye, underneath the shadow of thy wing, that place of protection. That's a great comfort to me, how God sees me. And he knows what I'm going through, as he knows what you're going through, how God is leading you and helping you. Verse 9, for the wicked, now he's making his plea, for the wicked that oppress me, for my deadly enemies who compass me. And of course, many times as David was fleeing from Saul, he was trapped, and they had him in, and yet the Lord delivered him over and over again. He felt like there was no way out. They have closed in their own fat, with the mouth they speak proudly. They have not compassed us in our steps. They have set their eyes bowing down to the earth. These guys are ready to pounce on me, as he was probably seeing them from his hiding place, a cave or whatever, and he saw this, you know, mass of fighting men that Saul had with him. And he says, they set their eyes bowing down to the earth. Verse 12. Like as a lion that is greedy of his prey, as it were a young lion lurking in secret places. Arise, O Lord, disappoint him, cast him down, deliver my soul from the wicked, which is thy sword, from the men which are thy hand, O Lord, from men of the world, which have their portion in this life, whose belly thou fillest with thy hid treasure. They are full of children, and they lead the rest of their substance to their babes. How true it is. The men of the world have their portion in this life, David is saying. You know, that's all they get. They fight, and they try to rise to the top, rise to power. Look at what's happening in our world today, in our nation, in the politics of the day, how they're so power hungry, because that's all they have out of life. Isn't that sad? That's what we got to tell people about. The alternative that they can have is the great abundant life that we have in Christ, not only here upon the earth now, but for eternity. Their portion is in this life. Our portion, of course, is in the Lord. Amen? Amen. As it tells us in verse 15, I love this. As for me, speaking of the contrast of those whose portion is in this life, I will behold thy face in righteousness. I shall be satisfied when I awake with thy likeness. Over and over through scriptures that we see from Genesis all the way through the end of the book of Revelation, it really does point us to a life that continues to go on, our eternal life. David here, in the midst of his struggles, and again, Saul's threat was real to him. His army was real. And here he's saying, as for me, I will behold thy face in righteousness. That's words of faith. I hope that you're making those same statements of faith, that Jesus Christ is coming back for me, and I'm going to spend eternity with him. Those are words of faith that I think will carry you through any troubles that you have for me. I will be satisfied. And isn't that beautiful? I'm not going to be satisfied until I wake up in the presence of the Lord. I want to continue to grow. Do you feel that in your own heart, that you want to grow in Jesus? You want to grow in your knowledge of him? He says, I'm not going to be satisfied until I wake up in that likeness. So David speaks of the hope of eternal life, of God's kingdom. When I wake up, it is a likeness. John said the same thing in 1 John chapter 3, verse 2. Beloved, now are we the sons of God. It doesn't yet appear what we're going to be, but we know that when he appears, we will be like him. We shall see him as he is. We're going to see the Lord face to face. I will wake up into his likeness. See, man, when you think about it, was made in the original image of God. It tells us there in creation, God said, let us make man in our image, or else after our likeness. And God created man in his image there in the beginning. But through sin, and let's make sure we understand that, there was a fall, there was a rebellion of man. And through sin, with that likeness of God, that image of God, started to erode quickly. As we read this, the account there in Genesis, and men have fallen so far from the image of God that it's difficult in this state, in the stage of history right now in our nation, to understand what the purposes of God are. I would to God, I pray for our nation. We're having riots once again. We're having protests. These are men and women that don't understand the purpose of God for their lives and what God has for them. If you want to know what the purpose of God is, let me clue you in. All you have to do is to look at the person of Jesus Christ. As you look at him, he's the one that the Father said, I'm well pleased in. He's the one that represents God the Father to us as you look at Jesus. I would highly encourage you, if you haven't read it for a while, to read the Gospel of John, from John chapter 1 all the way to the end, to be able to see the person of Jesus Christ as he is not only the reflection, but he's the presence, the mere image of God right here upon this earth, where he is representing God to us. The purpose of God sending his son Jesus Christ was to restore man back into the image of God, back into fellowship with the Lord. Paul said in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18, we all with open face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being changed from glory to glory, even into the same image, according to his Spirit that worketh in us. God wants to bring us into that beautiful place of fellowship with him. I believe, even from the rapture of the church, that we will be changed. We'll put on a body that's made for the heavens, that we will be changed. We'll be brought into that beautiful restoration, that place in fellowship with the Lord, where as God originally intended it there in the beginning. David is crying out. David is crying out, and he says, I won't be satisfied. I'm not going to be satisfied until I behold thy faith in righteousness. Don't be satisfied with the things of the world. Keep, as we saw in Colossians chapter 3, set your mind on the things of God, or things above, where Christ is sitting on the right-hand throne of God. Set your affections, your feelings, your emotions on the things that are above. And I love that verse so much, verse number 15. Well, I love them all. I hope that you've fallen in love with God's word. As we continue now, as we go into Psalm number 18, as he opens up and said, I love thee, O Lord, my strength. And thus, we're introduced to a psalm that was written by David, the best we can tell, that as Saul's been pursuing David, as we talked about, seeking to destroy David, that there's many times where David had felt that he had it in, that he was all done. He thought, man, this is it. And, you know, he would get backed up. He would get backed up, like I said, into a cave or someplace, and he felt that he was trapped and there was no way out. But all the tremendous ways, as we study not only there in 1 Samuel, the history of the life of David, how God made so many tremendous, miraculous deliveries for David. I will love thee, O Lord, my strength. When I say my strength, you heard me emphasizing it there. God should be always personal with us. That it's not, we're not talking about the great God that's just simply the God of everybody floating around someplace that, you know, some would like to say he's in everything, like the trees, and, you know, he's not really one that you could know. That's not the God of the Bible. The God of the Bible is very personal. David experienced that personal relationship with him, as we'll get in here in a week or two, where it says the Lord is my shepherd. Here he's saying the Lord is my strength. And I pray that you make it personal, that you're able to look at the Lord, your strength, even this day, that the Lord is my strength. Notice now, he gives us 8 my's in chapter 2, and if you include chapter 1, you have 9 where he says my strength. Notice where he says the Lord is my rock, he's the my fortress, my deliverer, my God, my strength, in whom I will trust, my buckler and the horn of my salvation, my high tower. Each one of those is something that, as he attributes these to God, how he finds his safety, finds his rest in the Lord. The rock is always, has been in scriptures, a symbol of strength. It's a hard rock per se, the rock of defense. The word rock here in the Hebrew is Selah, C-E-L-A in the Hebrew, is often used for what is known as the rock city of Petra. Mason and I have been down there before. We've had the privilege of, on our trips to Israel. Lord willing, maybe we'll be able to go one day again. As you go over to Israel, you head down south, and you go to a lot down south, a beautiful port city there on the Red Sea. You cross over to Jordan. A couple-hour ride, before you know it, you come into that rock city of Petra, that tremendous fortified city that he sees here. And he's saying, basically, he says, Lord, you're my rock city. This defense that you've given me is like nobody can attack me. The high tower was also always looked upon as a position of strength, as an advantage over the enemy. As he describes, the Lord is my high tower, where he could see, he had that advantage point, as the Lord has the advantage point over a situation. See, God can see the whole picture. And that's why something we need to discover, really, I think it brings us to a place to trust the Lord that much more. He says, Lord, you're my not only my rock, and you can read the rest of them in this psalm, but also my high tower. You see the whole thing that's going on. You see everything that's going on. And then in verse 3, with confidence, because of this, he says, I will call upon the Lord. I will. And with no doubt. Who is worthy to be praised, so shall I be saved from my enemies. Over and over and over. Why should I be saved upon his enemies? Because he knows the God personally, and that he can call upon the Lord. I hope that that's encouraging to you. I really do hope. Because we can call upon the Lord, you know, through our difficulties. In fact, in the New Testament, we discover one of the great works of Jesus is that he is our high priest. It's forever making intercession for us. It tells us that we can come boldly before the throne of grace to find mercy, to find grace in our time of need. David might not have known that scripture at this time when this was penned, but he knew God. He knew the access that he had, that he could go to him, and that he would be saved from his enemy. Now he describes it in verse 4. The sorrows of death compassed me, and the floods of the ungodly man made me afraid. And so he's telling the Lord in his prayer, the sorrows of hell compassed me about. The snares of death prevented me. Always the snares, speaking of a trap. They caught me in their ambush. And he says, there's no way out. And, you know, I think that's a good way to look at a lot of things that we see in our life, that there's no way out. But there is a way out by turning to the Lord. I look at the life of Joseph. Do you remember Potiphar's wife? She was a scoundrel, that lady. When she couldn't take advantage of Joseph, she tried to seduce him, but And she grabbed hold of Joseph's towel and tried to get him to lie with him, that are really this, you know, little cloth that Joseph had upon himself. David did what? He turned and he ran. He ran out of her clutches to get away from the Lord. He says, because the snares of death prevented me. Otherwise, there is an entrapment that wanted to keep me from serving the Lord. In verse 6, look at the prayer. He says, in my distress. If you're feeling stress right now, if you're feeling trouble right now, let's do what David did. He says, in my distress, I called upon the Lord and cried upon my God. He heard my voice out of his temple, and my cry came before him, even into his ears. A great way to describe God, how he came to his assistance. Cry upon the Lord. Call upon the Lord. He says, when God responded in verse 7, he says, then the earth shook and trembled, the foundations also, the hills moved, and they were shaken because he was wroth, because one of God's children were being taken advantage of. And so as we enter into the presence of the Lord, we have that unique relationship with God as one of God's children, as we're born into the family of God when we become born again. And so it's like your own children, if they come running in from playing outside and all of a sudden they said, you know, Susie or, I mean, David or Paul or whoever beat me up. And, you know, I can see my mom right now just go, wait a second, wanting to head out the door and take care of them. And so David's going into the presence of the Lord, crying out for the Lord, and God responded. In verse 8, he says, then there went up smoke out of his nostril and fire out of his mouth, devoured the coals were kindled by it. He bowed in the heavens also and came down, and darkness was upon his feet. Otherwise, he's describing if you've been in the Midwest, any place or some place where this tremendous thunderstorm was coming in, it's almost like before you know it, it could be nice and sunny, you could be out on a golf course playing golf, and all of a sudden this big storm comes in, and it's almost like you could hardly see in front of you how darkness had taken over. He rode upon the cherubs, which was one of the great angels that were cherub. He did fly, yea, they did fly upon the wings of the wind. He made darkness his secret place, and his pavilion round about him were dark waters and thick clouds in the sky. And the brightness that was before him was thick clouds past, hailstones and coals of fire. And the Lord also thundered in heaven, and the highest gave his voice, hailstones and coals of fire. Yea, he sent out his arrows and scattered them. And he shot out the lightning and discomfited them. Then the channels of waters were seen, and the foundations of the world were discovered at thy rebuke, O Lord, the blast of thy breath of thy nostrils. And so, again, the storm. The cloud came over. And a lot of the area where David was running from Saul was, of course, down south. If you picture Jerusalem, you go down south and heading towards the sea down there, the Dead Sea. And as he got, it's about halfway down, maybe a little bit further, is this little place called En Gedi. As you're going heading down there, you're up against these cliffs, these mountains that are off to your right as you're driving down, and they have these little widgets, they call them, or I call them little valleys that are running down the mountains. You know, you could be sitting there in the sun when you're there, and up on the mountain someplace, it could be storming like crazy, and next thing you know, it's sunny out, and all of a sudden, these waters come running, rushing down. It's almost like out there in the desert now, when here in Southern California, where you get a desert storm hits, and you get a flash flood going, and it can wipe out your road. And he says, you use nature to help protect me from Saul and the times of trouble. In verse 16, he sent from above, he took me. He drew me out of many waters. He delivered me from the strong enemies and from them that hated me, for they were too strong for me. Here David is giving God the glory, where things were overwhelming. I couldn't handle them. I turned to you and you made a way out. I think it's so good as we see God's hand upon us and certainly God's deliverance that we take time to praise him. We take time to give thanks unto the Lord for all that he's done. Verse 18, they prevented me in the day of my calamity, but the Lord was my stay. The Lord was my stay. He brought me forth also into a large place. He delivered me because he delighted in me. I was hemmed in the valley, and I've been trapped, and the Lord brought me out. He protected me from my enemies, and I love it, but the Lord was my stay. He was my anchor through all this, and the Lord rewarded me. In verse 20, the Lord rewarded me according to my righteousness, according to my cleanness of my hand. He has recompensed me. And again, this is one of David's earlier psalms we mentioned earlier, before he became king, before he fell. And he says, the Lord rewarded me because of my righteousness. I get it as he's saying that, but ultimately it's the righteousness of Christ. The work of true righteousness is found in the person of Jesus Christ. But now he tells, which is really admirable, in verse number 21, for I have kept the ways of the Lord. God blesses us, like what David was saying, my righteousness, I was seeking to do things that are right, Lord. I don't think he's claiming at this time that he's perfect. Because even as a young man, as a young king, he was making mistakes. He says, but I sought to keep the ways of the Lord. And I tell you, there's something you can get from this study tonight, is the determination of David to do things that are pleasing before the Lord. And if we set out, even this evening, if we make a commitment before the Lord and say, Lord, with my eyes, my thoughts, and my action, I'm going to want to set out to do everything that's right before you in the ways of the Lord. And how do you know the ways of the Lord? Well, he's given us through Genesis, through Revelation, what the words ways of the Lord is. And one of the things that I put into practice and I want to pass on to you is, as I study God's word, that I start praying. I says, Lord, open my eyes that I might behold wondrous things out of thy word or thy law. As I want to understand your ways, the way you would have me to live my life, my conduct and my actions, that how I want to do things that are right before you. He goes on. He says, for I have kept the ways of the Lord and have not wickedly departed from God. From all his judgments were before me, and I did not put away his statutes from me. Again, what are we talking about? It's a choice. He says, I choose to keep him front and center. I didn't push him away. I didn't ignore God's word. And if you're out there right now ignoring God's word, and if you feel that sense of the Holy Spirit convicted in your heart, as we mentioned the other day, is that you just simply need to repent. Is turn back to God, bring the Word of God front and center in your life, and seek to do the things that are pleasing before the Lord, because you can't ask God to bless you on one side of your mouth and then you live a life of carnality on the other side of your mouth or your life. And we need to keep God's Word front and center on the things that we do. In verse 23, I was also upright before him. I kept myself from my iniquity. Therefore, the Lord recompensed me according to my righteousness, according to the cleanness of my hand, and in my eyesight. And this is David's early experience that we saw earlier in verse 25. With the merciful, thou shalt show thyself merciful. With the upright man, thou shalt show thyself upright. And so David has been merciful to Saul in our story as you go back and study it. He had an opportunity to slay Saul several times, but he didn't do that. He, as I mentioned, he respected the anointing on Saul. And the beautiful thing is Jesus speaks about the merciful later on in the Sermon on the Mount. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 7, he says, Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 7, David was a merciful man. He was extending mercy on those that he came in contact. Why was that? Because God's mercy was upon his life. He was just simply passing on how God had treated him. Verse 26. With the pure thou shalt show thyself pure. With the forward thou shalt show thyself forward. For thou wilt save the afflicted people, but will bring down high looks. For thou wilt light my candle, for the Lord my God will lighten my darkness. For by thee I have run through troops, and by my God I have leaped over walls, or over wall. I think we all can understand why David is such a hero for so many of us. And I would have loved, if I lived in any other time in history, you ever thought that? Oh, what period of time would I want to live? My goodness, I'd like to live there with David and go running, you know, and run through a troop. He had such a vigor about him. He really believed in God, and he had that desire just to serve the Lord. He was a leader of men. And my goodness, men did certainly follow his leadership. In verse 30, he says, as for God, and this is so important. Look at verse 30. As for God, his way is perfect. It's complete. The word of the Lord is tried. It's been tested. He is a buckler to all those who trust in him. He's your shield. And I just think it's so important that we understand God's ways compared to the ways of the world and what we're seeing set before us in the media today. There's no alternative. You have a choice to make. Won't you just choose the Lord? Because his way is perfect. The word of the Lord has been tried over the period of time. It's been tested and found to be faithful. Verse 31, for who is God, says the Lord? Who is the rock, save our God? Verse 31 is a great passage that I would love to preach on someday. But who is God? Great, great question, isn't it? Says the Lord. Who, you know, God has, when you measure up the God of the Bible to all the gods of this world, only the God of the Bible can stand. And even as you just look at the prophetic statements of the Bible, how each and every one of them have come 100% true. No other religion in the entire world could stand up compared to the truth and how the authority of which God has spoken. God's word has been inspired. It's been inspired by the Holy Spirit, and it's well-founded. In verse 32, it is God that girdeth me with strength and makes my way perfect. He makes my feet like hinds' feet, and he sets me upon high places. The prophet Habakkuk in Habakkuk chapter 3 speaks about a position of faith. Somebody, when he really looked at his difficult situation, he basically quotes this. He says, you know, when I look at things through faith, he says, God, you make my feet like hind feet, and you set me upon high places. Again, this might be a reference back to En Gedi, where they have these really kind of a small animal, the ibex. They're you know, you find them up there on the hillside. They're a beautiful animal with these long horns, but they can just climb all over these sides of these mountains without falling down. And so David says, you keep me in such a secure place. He says, you make my feet like the ibex feet, and you hide me in these, really in the cleft of your rocks. Verse 34, he teaches my hand to war, so that a bow of steel is broken in by my arms. Otherwise, I'm able to bend a bow. I'm able to bend, and it snaps because you teach my hands to war. I know there's a lot of people seem to have trouble with this verse, but I really don't. We're in a battle, and people don't seem like to realize the battle that we're in. We're in a spiritual battle. The Bible tells us, Paul writes, that the battle is not against flesh and blood, against physical people. He says, but against principalities and powers and the spirit forces and high places, otherwise the wickedness in high places. But if you don't realize that you're in a real spiritual battle, you know, you're at a disadvantage because the enemy can come and at any time and bring you discouragement and really to pull the rug out from underneath you. It's so important that, as David says, Lord, you've taught my hands to war. Paul in Ephesians chapter 6 tells us that we should stand in the power of God's might. He says that we should put on the full armament of God, put it completely, totally on. He says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, like I mentioned earlier, that we put on the full armor of God. I would encourage you to read it over as the Lord prepares us each and every day for the spiritual battle that we go out and that we face. Verse 35, thou hast also given me a shield of thy salvation, and thy right hand hath hold me up, and the gentleness hath made me great. The gentleness. Notice the gentleness has made me great. I think a real picture of strength is not the flying of an arrow or a steady bow. You know, as you see, you know, sometimes you see pictures or statues of a really strength of somebody shooting off a bow or letting it go. That's not a real sign of strength, but rather it's the sign that you're so strong that you're able to withhold your own strength and extend mercy onto others. David had done that many times with Saul's life. He says, by doing that, you taught me what it means to be great and not using my power, my position to bully over other people. Now again, I pray for our politicians this day that we would understand that the privilege that God has given them, because God is the one that's risen them up, is a position of privilege that they should use their power to destroy rather than build up. Verse 36, thou hast enlarged my steps under me, that my feet did not slip. Otherwise, when I was in trouble, I didn't slip, and my feet did not slip. I had pursued my enemies and overtake them. Neither did I turn again till they were consumed. Verse 38, I have wounded them that they were not able to rise. They are fallen under my feet. For thou hast girded me with strength under the battle. Thou hast subdued under me those that rose up against me. Thou hast also given me the necks of my enemy that I might destroy them that hate me. They cried, but there was none to save them, even unto the Lord, but he answered them not. Then did I beat them small as the dust before the wind. I did cast them out as the dirt in the street. Thou hast delivered me from the striving of my people. Thou hast made me the head of the heathens, a people whom I have not known shall serve me. He's talking really about, again, going back, looking at the history of his, as he enters into the kingdom, his own kingdom, the Davidic kingdom, how the victories that God gave him over his enemies. And he's given thanks, and he's honoring God. Did you hear, thou hast done, thou hast did this. Otherwise, God, you're the one that's been my strength, you're the one that's been my help. In verse 44, and as soon as they heard of me, they shall obey me. The strangers shall submit themselves unto me. The strangers shall fade away and be afraid out of their close places. The Lord liveth. Blessed be my rock. Let the God of my salvation be exalted. He says, those foreign countries, the countries are going to hear about your great work that you've did, and they won't attack us. They're not going to come into our land because of what you did. As in verse 46, he says, he cries out, he says, because the Lord liveth, that's my victory. That's who I find strength in. In verse 47, it is God that avenges me and subdues the people under me. He delivered me from my enemies. Yea, and thou liftest me up above those that rise up against me. Thou hast delivered me from the violent man. Therefore will I give thanks unto thee, O Lord, among the heathen, and sing praises unto thee, unto thy name. And so he's worshiping the Lord now. As he sees the deliverance of God, his faith has brought him to a place to trust God. His faith was able to say, God, your word is true. I know that you'll take care of me. And it brings him to a place as he's worshiping the Lord. Verse 50, great deliverance giveth he to his king, and he shows mercy to his anointed, to David and to his seed forever and ever. Yet David is not king yet. He hasn't been anointed king, but he realizes this is something that is in his future, something that God has for him, as he's trusting God's word. I pray that each and every one of us would come to that place of finding great trust in the Lord. There's things that are fearful out there, but God's not fearful. We shouldn't be fearful of God, and he's the one that holds our future. You know, don't look to the left, don't look to the right and everything else, but look to the Lord for your strength, for your help. And don't necessarily trust CNN, don't trust Fox News, but trust the Lord. Trust the things that God has to say, because God's word is sure. It's been tested. It's been proven to be true. And I know that as I go to the Lord, and I just love reading the scriptures. It doesn't matter where we're at, where I, you know, as I look at it, I just open up my Bible and I'm starting to read here in Matthew chapter 6, verse 19. Maybe we'll just finish with this verse here tonight. Lay not up for yourself treasures upon the earth, where moth does corrupt and where thieves break through and steal. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, may we take that to heart. May we take to heart that we don't lay up our treasures upon this earth, but we look to the eternal, that we trust you. Help us to grow in our faith, and that sometimes our faith, when it does waver, Lord, that you might strengthen us, that we keep our eyes upon you. So thus we trust you in you and give you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. And if you run into any of your friends, you know, friends of Agape Chapel, people who might not know, remind them next Sunday morning, Sunday evening, where we're going to be. We're going to be at Agape Chapel there at Hillcrest. So looking forward to being with you. So may God richly bless you.
Lord, don't let me strive against my brother. I'm so tired of it, don't want to do it no more. Lord, don't let us fight against each other. Let us be one in you. Lord, give us love for one another. And what we say, yes, in what we do. Lord, teach us to build up one another. Let us be one. So we can hear it. Let us be one in you.